Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup with People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from across the globe. Let's take a look at today's headlines. Taliban declares that it will not agree to extend the deadline for evacuations. Israeli forces open fire on Palestinian protesters near Gaza's eastern border. Thousands of nurses across Denmark continue strike for fair pay. Seoul metro workers warn of countrywide strike against restructuring plans. And in the video section, we take a look at the surge in violence against women during the COVID-19 pandemic. The Taliban has stated that all foreign forces must withdraw from Afghanistan by the set deadline. This was after US President Joe Biden said that evacuations might extend beyond August 31st. UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson has also stated that there is no hard deadline. The G7 countries will now hold a meeting on the issue on August 24th with restrictions placed around the Kabul airport. The WHO has stated that 500 tons of aid supplies are stuck. Meanwhile, Afghan civilians have continued to gather at the airport to try and flee the country. Desperate families have also handed over babies and children to foreign soldiers. Moreover, NATO officials have stated that at least 20 people have been killed in the area since last week. An Afghan soldier was also killed during a firefight outside the airport on Monday. German and US forces were also involved in the incident. Meanwhile, the Taliban announced that it had reportedly recaptured 3 districts from Afghan militias. A spokesperson stated that the group was now established in Badakhshan, Takhar and Andarab near the Panjshir Valley. 41 Palestinians were injured after Israeli forces opened fire during a protest on August 21st. Hundreds of people had gathered at the Gaza-Israel border to protest the ongoing siege. The day also marked 52 years since the arson attack on the Al-Aqsa Mosque in 1969. Palestinians gathered near the Malaka refugee camp on Saturday following afternoon prayers. However, Israeli forces soon opened fire and launched volleys of tear gas at the protesters. The Palestinian Health Ministry stated that at least 2 people were seriously injured, including a 13-year-old child. 27 people were shot with live rounds in their lower extremities. 2 people were shot in the arm and 2 in the abdomen. The Israeli military claimed that protesters had hurled explosive devices. A sniper was also injured. Later on Saturday, Israel launched several airstrikes on Gaza, claiming it had hit Hamas sites. 11 people were wounded in the attack. Palestinian resistance movements also opened fire on Israeli drones that were hovering at a low altitude. Israel has carried out multiple airstrikes on Gaza in violation of the ceasefire declared in May. The 11-day bombardment killed over 260 Palestinians. Thousands of buildings, including homes, schools and hospitals, were damaged. However, the over 14-year-long blockade means that materials needed for reconstruction are not available. Moreover, Egyptian forces also announced on August 23rd that the Rafah border crossing with Gaza had been closed. Over 5,000 nurses have been on strike across Denmark since June 19th, organized by the Danish Nurses Organization, or DSR. They are fighting for a fair contract. The strike began after the union's 75,000 members rejected an offer by public employers. They had offered a 5% pay increase over 3 years. The DSR has demanded a pay rise, additional staff and recognition of the work done during the pandemic. They have also denounced the pay gap in traditionally female versus male dominated professions. In particular, nurses have rejected the 1969 civil service reform. The union argues that it placed female dominated professions lower in the pay hierarchy. According to the DSR, nurses' salaries are 15-20% lower than groups with a comparable level of education. While negotiations seem to have reached a deadlock, the strike is now expanding. 225 nurses, including fertility services staff, joined strike on August 17th. Another 315 people, including workers from nursing homes, will walk out on August 31st. Meanwhile, the striking nurses have also held protests and demonstrations outside the Danish parliament. Train workers in South Korea's capital city have announced a strike. Unionized workers at Seoul Metro are protesting the company's restructuring plan. This includes a 10% cut in the workforce, which means that over 1,500 workers will lose their jobs. It also includes a freeze on wages, a reduction in benefits, and outsourcing to the private sector. Seoul Metro is expected to have a loss of 1.6 trillion won this year. Workers are demanding that the company receive the same government support as the Korea Railroad Corporation, 60% of Korea's annual losses are recovered using government funds. 81.6% of workers at Seoul Metro have supported a strike after a vote held last week. They have stated that they will stage a full walkout on September 14th if their demands are not met. Workers are asking for state subsidies for lost income and a new process of hiring. Meanwhile, the strike could extend beyond Seoul to at least four other cities. Workers in Busan, Daegu, Daejeon, and Incheon have all voted in favor of a walkout. And for a final story, we look at emerging data on violence against women during the COVID-19 pandemic. According to the UN, 1 in 3 women worldwide experienced physical or sexual violence. Preliminary data by various sources shows that this violence grew in 2020. In Argentina, emergency calls to gender-based violence helplines grew by 39%. After the implementation of stay-at-home orders, domestic violence grew by 8.1% in the US. In Brazil, 649 femicides were documented in the first half of 2020. UN agencies and rights groups have termed the surge in violence the shadow pandemic. Here is a video feature by Brazil De Fato on this issue.
This August is the 15th anniversary of the Maria da Penha Law, legal device for the protection of women suffering domestic violence. According to the Brazilian Public Safety Forum, every 2 minutes a woman is victim of this type of violence in Brazil. With the pandemic, the isolation had an impact on these figures. In the Northeast region, the state of Pernambuco has a 36% increase in the number of complaints. It is the state with the most occurrences in the entire region.
Indeed, what the pandemic did was exacerbate those situations that already existed. No offender became an offender because of the pandemic. The aggressions already existed. It turns out that as the aggressor was not with his wife and children all the time, the women had managed to bear it somehow.
The Maria da Penha law helped us to achieve this. It helped women to recognize something that happens to them. The law was very emblematic because it is named after a woman who was attacked, almost murdered, a woman who reacted and showed her pain. So I think this stimulated and gave courage to many women to follow Maria da Penha's example.
Despite the laws to restrain this kind of violence, the housing help demands are still very high. Therefore, several non-governmental organizations such as Tamo Juntas give free support and guidance.
If not for the third sector, women would be much more helpless because the demand is higher than the given support. So when we see the media saying that every 2 minutes one woman is a victim of violence, there is no government, no city that has the necessary structure to support these victims today.
The spreading of information and the stimulus for complaints are fundamental for a fairer, more egalitarian, and less violent society.
A society cannot be considered democratic, it cannot be regarded as egalitarian or human if women are treated that way.
And that's all the time we have for this episode of the International Daily Roundup. For more such stories and videos, visit our website peoplesdispatch.org, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thank you for watching.